derived from a Latin word meaning a new star. However, nova is not a new star. It is a suddenly increase in the brightness of a star before getting back down to normality. So if we want to know what are novae and supernovae exactly, they are stars suddenly become visible because of the increasing of their luminosity. So you can see, and also I want to say that supernovae was discovered by Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe in 1572. And you can see here on the top, on the right, this Tycho Brahe supernovae, SN1572, also known as Vesuvius supernova. It was one of the eight supernovae visible to the naked eye. Actually, supernovae, when are discovered, they are named SN, and then comes the calendar year, and then the letter behind it is for discovery. So, for example, you can see this supernova 1987. It first was seen in nearby large Magellanic Cloud, and it was the closest supernova since the invention of the telescope. So, when we talk about supernovae and how was it detected, there are a burst of neutrinos that has been detected, these neutrinos that they detected is almost less than 3 seconds, which indicates it is a final phase of a star. And this is an important of discovering supernova. Okay, to understand the mechanism that leading to supernova and nova, we want first to understand how stars work. Also, we want to understand how different star mass, how different mass star live and how they die in order to understand supernovae and novae. What you are seeing right now, this is the life and evolution of stars. For example, I will start by this molecular cloud. Stars are born in this molecular cloud for maybe a couple of tens years. Because of such a huge gravity, they are collapse under their own weight. And as do they collapse, the pressure is going to increase, and then it will get hot and hot until they reach a certain degree. We can take the hydrogen and fuse it. When a nuclear fusion starts, we can say a star is born. So this molecular cloud that collapsed under their own weight, also it may split to another molecular cloud, and each molecular cloud have a given star with a given mass. Why? Because stars, how do they end up? All it depends upon the mass of stars, because all stars have the same birth process, which is collapse of this huge cloud. But in terms of how, all it depends upon the mass. So usually we divide stellar evolution into two groups. Those stars that have mass less than 8 solar masses, we call them low mass star. And those stars that have bigger than 8 solar masses, we call them massive star. But the question is, how do they evolve? In order to understand how do they evolve, all it depends upon the mass, because as we know that a star is going to see several kinds of nuclear fusion. And what kind of a nuclear fusion, it depends upon how hot it is interior, and how hot it is interior, it depends upon how massive it is. For example, I will start here. For example, for a star like our star, sun, the Sun, how do they evolve? They evolve after consuming 90% of the hydrogen inside it. And then will evolve to a red giant, as you can see here. But how does they do that? Once they finish 90% of the hydrogen inside it, the star is going to collapse under it is on weight. And as do they collapse under its own weight, the pressure is going to increase, and it will get hot and hot. Nuclear fusion happened inside the star, burning hydrogen to helium. But as on a star was fusing hydrogen, it is in equilibrium now. What is the meaning of equilibrium? When we have pressure in due to gravity mass, and pressure out due to nuclear energy generated inside the star. So some kind of push in and push out, when there is a balance between push out and push in, the star is in equilibrium, and this star is the main sequence star. So any star that burning hydrogen to make helium is the main sequence star. It is a normal star. But this balance will not stay forever. At some point, the star will lose its equilibrium. After 90% of the hydrogen is consumed inside the star, the nuclear fusion will stop, and the star will lose its equilibrium and will collapse under its own weight. And as it collapse, it will get the pressure is going to increase, and it will get hotter and hotter. So for a star like our star, the Sun, for example, our Sun, after 5 or 6 billion years, this is what will happen to it. It will grow in size, it will expand, it will be as big as the distance between Earth and the Sun right now, and it will still burning. I forget to mention that when the star is burn, when a star is expanding, another reaction will start. Another reaction is fusing helium to make carbon. So when a star, let's return back, when a star consumed it is hydrogen, it will going to collapse under their own weight, and the pressure is going to increase, and then the helium that made out of hydrogen, we can now start to fuse. So burning helium to make carbon, this is the second reaction will start, and this is the more reaction, the more energetic reaction. So our sun, after 5 or 6 billion years, it will grow up in size, and it will become, as I mentioned, as big as the distance between Earth and the sun. And it will still burning helium to make carbon, but for sure this helium is not unlimited. At some point it will get exhausted. So the star will expand, and now it is a red giant star, and will collapse because there is no pressure or no energy push out their layer. So it will collapse under its own weight, and the central core, it will be as a white dwarf. The remains from a white dwarf is this beautiful planetary nebula. This is a whole story. So here we can see two kinds of nuclear fusion. Nuclear fusion number one, fusing hydrogen to helium, and nuclear fusion number two, burning helium to make carbon. So our star, the sun, and those stars that have mass less than 8 solar masses will end up as a white dwarf. And once a star reach a white dwarf, there is no more energy inside it. There is no nuclear fusion inside it, but it is still hot. And a white dwarf has an average size as the size of a planet Earth. But mass of the white dwarf does not exceed 1.4 solar mass. And that is called Chandrasekhar limit. I'm going to explain it in details as I move on. So no white dwarfs can sustain mass bigger than 1.4. And some of white dwarfs can be in a binary star system. Because a white dwarf has such a huge gravity. And if happen to be in a binary star system, a white dwarf is going to suck much more matter from their companion, the mass is going to increase. It does reach 1.4, the Chandrasekhar limit. And then physically the star is going to explode as supernova type 1A. So supernova type 1A can occur in a binary star system when one of the two stars is a white dwarf star. This is the whole story for low mass star. And if we come to massive star, those stars that have mass bigger than 8 solar mass, they have a different story. they will not stop at burning high burning helium to make carbon. They will go beyond it until they reach iron phase. Iron element is the last element in the star. Is the last element that can be formed in the star, because fusing iron requires more such energy. So, for example, if you take even if you take a star, super massive star that has mass that have mass bigger than 100 times the mass of the sun, it does not have energy, that energy to fuse iron. So for those stars, when it they reach iron phase, there is so much energy consumed, and they are going to collapse under their own weight, and this collapse is very fast. So the pressure is going to increase very fast, and it will become hot and hot, and then will the star will explode as supernova type 2. So supernova type 2, the remnant of supernova type 2 depends upon the initial mass of a star. For example, if we have mass bigger than 4-8 solar masses, the star will end up as a black hole. And if we have stars, those stars have mass less than 4-8 masses, it will end up as 40 solar masses, it will end up as a neutron star, and a neutron star maybe will become as a pulsar, or maybe some of neutron star, maybe it will be in a binary star system, and it will give us X-ray binaries. This is the whole story. So our talk today is going to emphasize on supernova type 1 and supernova type 2. And as you see that supernova type 1 can occur in binary star system, and one of the two stars is a white dwarf. And supernova type 2 is the result of explosion of the massive star. So what are the physical processes leading to novae? Novae actually same as supernova type 1a occur in a binary star system. It should be a closed binary system, and one of those stars, one of the two stars is a white dwarf, carbon oxygen white dwarf, and the other star is a red giant star. So white dwarfs will suck much more matter from their companion, and it's going to increase, its mass is going to increase until it reaches 1.4 Chandrasekhar limit, and then will explode as novae, as you can see here. This is the white dwarf, oxygen carbon white dwarf, and this is their companion. And you can see here in this picture, Nova Hercules. This is peak brightness, and after the 2 months, you can it become faint. This is short video.
If the companion is very close to the white wall, when it enters the red dark stage, its outer layers can be pulled off by the white wall. If enough matter is transferred from one star to the other, the mass of the white wall will continue to increase until it reaches critical mass. At this point, the white wall is too massive to sustain it. Therefore, it explodes the final supernova. This is what's known as the Type 1A supernova. This always occurs at this critical mass, but this critical mass is about 1.4 times the mass of the Sun. And therefore, the brightness of the supernova is very predictable. So, the most recent and nearby supernova of this type occurred in a spiral galaxy called Messier 1.1. This lies around 20 million light years away, so it's not a very close galaxy. It was first observed in August 2011, and was quite visible to the telescope in weeks after the exposure.
In this video, this is the story how the mechanism that leading to supernova type 1A, but actually supernova type 1A is similar to Novi. So what are the physical process leading to supernovae? We have two types of supernovae. We have supernovae type 1A, type 1, and supernovae 1, supernovae type 2. Supernovae type 1 actually occur in a closed binary star system, as I mentioned, and one of them carbon oxygen white dwarf, and the other one is a red giant star. But the second type of supernovae, it is the result of the explosion of massive star. So here also this video.
Mark, can you increase the audio of your video?
To be honest, the material that we found at its core was flung out into space. This is what's known as a type 2 supernova. Although if you observe a star that seems to have a hydrogen envelope of layers around it, you can often call it a type 1B or a type 1C supernova. The second type of supernova only seems to affect stars that are 8 to 9 times mass of our sun. If a star has a mass of 20 to 30 times the mass of our sun, the remaining material will be so massive and so dense that it could form a black hole. But you can even get stars that are even more massive. You can get stars that are about 40 to
30 times the solar mass.
Yeah, I told her she is not hearing us, maybe.
Okay.
Now we are hearing nothing.
Or not. My voice is clear?
Yeah, your voice is clear, but the video is not clear at all. But that's fine, you can move on.
Okay. Okay. So as you see in this two videos, the mechanism that leading to novae and supernovae, and also the two types of supernovae, type 1 and type 2. And now I'm going to talk about electron degeneracy. Electron degeneracy is a stellar application of the Pauli exclusion principle. Because as we know that laws of quantum mechanics prohibit two electrons from occupying same state in same place. A quantum state is equal to energy level plus spin. And spin is electron spin, which is up and down. So degeneracy pressure depends upon on the degenerate particles. It depends on the heat. I'm going to explain it in details as I move on. So you can see here in these two pictures, here you can see regular gas, and here you can see degenerate gas. As you know that most stars are supported against their gravitational by normal thermal gas pressure, while a white dwarf is supporting the supporting force is come from the electron degeneracy pressure. So that why I'm going to explain it here. So as you can see here, a regular gas, there is many unfilled energy levels, particle free energy levels. Also, particles are free to move from one level to another. But in degenerate gas, all lower levels, as you can see, filled with two particles. And as I mentioned, in a quantum state, we have energy level and spin. So as you can see, this spin up and spin up, spin up and spin down, and take one energy level as a quantum state state 4. You will see here all lower energy levels filled with two particles, and each have a different spin. And they are locked in this place. I'm going to explain it more here. The normal gas the normal gas that is supported against the gravitational inside the star. The pressure. The pressure in atoms depends the temperature of atoms here depends upon the movement of the gas. So an atom moves faster, the atom it will be hot and hotter, and as an atom moves slower, it will become cool and cool. So the normal pressure depends upon the temperature. So you can see here the difference between them. As I mentioned, thermal pressure depends upon temperature, and the generosity pressure depends upon the speed of the degenerate particles. However, adding heat does not increase the speed of most of the electrons, because all the electrons are stuck in fully occupied quantum state. So the dead stars, we have here white dwarfs, neutron stars, and black hole. White dwarfs supported by electron degeneracy pressure, and neutron stars supported by neutron degeneracy pressure, the regular stars supported by the normal thermal gas pressure. So these all degenerate stars, we have brown dwarfs, white dwarfs, and neutron star. White dwarfs and brown star and brown dwarfs all are supported by electron degeneracy pressure, but neutron stars supported by neutron degeneracy pressure. So as I mentioned, when any stars reach a white dwarf, there will be no more nuclear reaction inside it, but white dwarf is still hot, and it is still shining, maybe for billions years, until when disappear from our own sight, it will become as a black dwarf or brown dwarf. And as I mentioned that white dwarfs has an average size as the size of a planet Earth. Not exceed 1.4, which is the Chandrasekhar limit. So you can see here this white dwarf in a planetary nebula, and this white dwarf in globular cluster M4, and this white dwarf companion of Ceres, which is the brightest star in the night sky. Chandrasekhar limit. Chandrasekhar limit, Chandrasekhar combine the idea of relativity with the quantum mechanics. As you know that Einstein's theory of relativity says that nothing moves faster than light, and when electron speeds in white dwarf approach speed of light, electron degeneracy pressure can no longer support it. So Chandra found this happens when a white dwarf's mass reach 1.4 solar masses. Chandra limit, when electron degeneracy pressure cannot support a white dwarf heavier than 1.4 solar masses. You can see here how to estimate the Chandrasekhar mass limit from Fermi, kinetic energy of Fermi gas electron. You can see this the equation that Chandrasekhar limit used to find the mass limit of Chandrasekhar, and it equal 1.4 solar masses. Also, I'm going to talk about Roche loop. If you notice that I mentioned degeneracy, gas pressure, Chandrasekhar limit, and now Roche loop, and all of these we are going to see it in a closed binary system. which is the main result one of the mechanism that leading to NOFA and supernova type 1a. Roche loop, the definition of Roche loop is the equipotential surfaces of a gravitational force in atom body system, in two body system. So as you can see here, we have two body system. For example, let's imagine one of them is a white dwarf and the other one is a red giant. You will notice here between them, there is a Lagrangian point. But Roche loop has four different types. You will see here, we have detached binary, semi-detached, and we have a contact binary over contact. In a closed binary system, when the material that crosses the Roche loop can be transformed to another star into orbit in the system or ejected. So mass transfer in a closed binary system occurs when one overflows its Roche loop. And this is we will see in semi-detached binary system. I'm going to explain it in details here. A detached binary system, we have two stars and neither stars fill it is Roche loop. So there is no transfer matter here. And semi-detached binary, we will see that one star fills its Roche loop. So this is here will happen transfer for mass. And a contact binary Roche loop, we have two stars. And all stars fill their Roche loop. So here will have an overflow of them and will share with each other the mass. And we can see here over contact binary, the two of two stars overfill their Roche loop, and the two stars share the same outer atmosphere. Okay, supernova classification. Supernova are classified into two types depending upon the shape of the light curves and the nature of their spectra. So you will see here we have two types of supernova. We have supernova type 1 and supernova type 2. Supernova type 1 have no hydrogen lines in their spectra, while supernova type 2 have hydrogen lines in their spectra. Also, we can divide supernova type 1 into three subclasses. We have supernova type 1a, and those have silicon lines in their spectra. And supernova type 1b and 1c, actually there are similar in the how do they occur, because they all explode from massive stars, but they are different in their spectra. Supernova type 1b have no silicon, have helium in their spectra, while supernova 1c have no silicon and no helium in their spectra. And if we come to supernova type 2, we divide it into two subclasses. depending upon the light curve. So we have type 1-1b, plateau, and we have type 1-1n. This is linear and plateau. I'm going to explain it in details as I move on. So supernova type 1a, as I mentioned, that they have no hydrogen in their spectra, but they have no hydrogen in their spectra, but they have a strong silicon lines in their spectra, and they occur or the result from a close binary star system, and one of the binary of the two stars, carbon oxygen star, and carbon oxygen star. And here you can see this spectra of supernova type 1a. As you can see here, they have a silicon line spectra. And if we come to type 1b, you will notice in this, this is the spectra of type 1b. You will see they have a strong helium lines spectra in their spectrum. Also, they produced by core collapse in massive star. And type 1c, you will notice here in their spectra, there is no hydrogen and no helium lines in their spectra. And also they produced by core collapse in a massive star. And the last one, type 2 supernova, if you see the spectrum, you will see, you will notice here a strong hydrogen lines in their spectrum. They produced by core collapse in a massive star. So you can see here these spectral features as are illustrated. So all types of supernova, you can see it here. This is supernova type 1a. You will notice there is no hydrogen lines, but there is strong silicon lines. And supernova type 2, there is a strong hydrogen lines in their spectra. Supernova type 1c, there is silicon in their spectra. And supernova type 1b, there is silicon and there is helium in their spectra. So here summarize for this graph. I mentioned before. So if we come to a light curve of the supernovae, the light curve, as you can see here, this is on the right. You will see, first of all, we want...
We have 5 minutes left, Fatima, 5 minutes.
Okay. A light curve is a graph that shows the brightness of an object over a period of time. So here in this in this light curve, you will see on the horizontal axis days after explosion, and here you will see the magnitude. The luminosity of the explosion. So as you can see, here is the tip of explosion, and slowly it will decay after less than 50 days. So you can see here, going to explain in details here. You will notice in light curve of supernovae type 1, two decays. The first one, this decay happened before after the explosion less than 50 days. And here you will see nickel elements. It is dominated by electron capture. And the second decay, the downward slope here, happened less than 100 days after the explosion. And here you will see a cobalt element. And finally, the light curve of supernova type 2. We have two types of light curve. Here we have linear, and here we have Pluto. Linear as similar to supernova type 1A, and the same rate of the reaction, and also the same rate of decay. But supernova type 2, Pluto, we can see here different rate of reaction and also different elements. And all elements that we can see here, it is from radioactive of the explosion itself. So this is I mentioned the importance of supernova. One of the most important of supernovae. We have supernovae type 1A. It is a standard candle, and it is used to measure or calculate the distance to other galaxies because supernova type 1A. All have the same absolute magnitude, about minus 19.3. So just here, pictures, this is the dwarf novae, and here classical novae, as I mentioned, in a binary star system. Also, you can see here, this is the classical novae, and here also, this is a dwarf nova, and this is the nova type 1A. And maybe time. And also, this is the supernova from white dwarf, supernova type 1A. Summary, I'm going to summarize. We have two types of supernovae. We have type 1 and type 2, and we divided according to their spectra and light curve. We, as you see in this talk, supernova type 1A occur in our closed binary system star, one of them carbon oxygen dwarf star, and the other one red giant star. And supernovae type 2 and supernovae type 1b and c, all the result from the explosion of massive star. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fatima, for this very concise and informative lecture. So I open the floor for the audience. If you have any questions, please.
Yes, Fatima. Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam.
Yes, I want to ask about the nova will become a star, will become a nova when it must be a binary system.
Yeah.
Only, for example, our sun will become a white dwarf, as we know.
Yeah.
Red giant and white dwarf, but it will not become in the end as a nova, isn't it?
Actually, if our sun, we have to answer. If our sun reach a red giant, and there is a companion for our sun, for example, white dwarf is gonna to be to happen nova. But if our sun reaches white dwarf, it will look for another companion, which is the red giant, and will become a supernova. It should have companion.
It should have companion. That's why. But it's occur in.
It is okay.
It's occur in a white in a binary system only, not yes. only in the sun. It will not come a nova. What I understand.
Wait, Mohammed. So. I will ask Professor.
Yes.
It is okay, yes. Professor.
What you said also, Fatima. So a nova can only happen if you have a binary star system and one of the two stars is a white dwarf. Otherwise, there is no nova.
No. Okay. Thank you.
Any other question, please? Okay, no questions. So thank you very much, Fatima. And thank you very much for the audience. For the attendance. So we see you in about 2 weeks' time. There's another lecture, I believe, by Miss Selma. She will talk about what? I don't know. I'll have to check my to check my files. Okay, thank you very much. So have a good day and stay safe, inshallah. Shukran, Muhammad.
Ya Allah, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.